was waving in the back. We have our Out Now table. Out Now is one of the sponsors of tonight, and Out Now is Springfield's only LGBTQ youth organization. And we've been doing a lot of anti-prison organizing for many years. So this was sort of a natural place for us to join in when we were working on the Justice for Donald campaign. And we're really happy to be here. If you want to look at any of our materials, Tiana's holding the table down in the back. We also have sponsorship tonight from the First Churches of Northampton, and the Peace and Justice Committee has welcomed us in here this evening. So give them a little round of woo-hoo! And Arise for Social Justice is also a co-sponsor of this evening's event. So here we are, and we have a really amazing panel tonight. I'm really, really happy to have a chance to hear this whole crew talk about this situation that has happened with Donald Perry, and broader than that, with the Massachusetts parole system in general. So we're going to kick off the night with Donald's story. And let me just tell you a little about Donald Perry. Donald Perry holds a BA from the University of Massachusetts with a focus on the politics of social inequalities. Currently, Mr. Perry is working to record his own experience of 18 years incarceration and his process of reintegration. After his lengthy incarceration, Mr. Perry spent almost 11 years on parole, where he personally experienced how the parole system actually plays out on a human level. Mr. Perry gives his audience an insider's view of his experience in hopes of raising greater awareness of the overall pitfalls of the parole system. Mr. Perry's journey on parole was recently documented by film producer Joe Berlinger, who produced an 8-part justice documentary called The System. Mr. Perry is featured in episode number 5, to be aired on June 15th of this year. And for local broadcast listings, you can see Al Jazeera, The System, and we actually printed out a whole listing of the series that's on the table up there. So you might want to check that out, and you can follow Donald's release from prison and talk to any of these folks that were also in the film as well. So we're going to start out with Donald, and then we're going to go down the row to all of these other amazing panelists. And there is a handout sheet up there of all the panelists, and you can see for yourself the description that I'm reading of them as well. And I guess I should say I'm Holly Richardson, and I work with Out Now, and I'm a member of Arise for Social Justice, and have been a part of the Justice for Donald campaign since the beginning, when Luke let me know what was going on, and we talked about joining the campaign at Arise and Out Now, and really helped work to see what was going on with parole and help him gain his freedom. And I hope we contributed something positive to that. Surely we learned a lot. And I got to know Donald over the last couple of years and feel like I have a lot of my love in my heart for this man, and his partner Elaine too, I should say. So Donald, why don't you start us out and take it away.
Good evening. Welcome everyone, and thank you for coming. And I guess my first question would be, by a show of hands, how many people in this room have ever did something wrong? Come on. I know it's more than me. Somebody been naughty in here besides me, all right? Well, interesting enough, whatever consequences that you had to pay in that instance, I've had to continuously suffer for my past misdeeds. Every time somebody pulls me over, every time somebody look at my criminal history, every time someone finds out that I'm a parolee. This was pretty much the case on August 3rd, 2011. I left home about 7:30 in the morning, on my way to a board of directors meeting at Valley CDC. On my way, I saw a gentleman who had his backpack and 2 black bags, basically all of his belongings. I do what I normally do. I picked him up to give him a ride. Coming into Northampton, because people come into Northampton, the drop-in center is right down the street. They come in for breakfast and showers. And the reason why I picked this gentleman up, because I was an outreach worker also. And the way that we build rapport with people is to meet them where they are. And meeting them where they are was simply, this individual asked me for a ride in this instance. If I give him a ride, then later on I see him probably at the drop-in center. Oh, my office used to be right downstairs also. I had a food pantry down there. So people could come in and get food. And incidentally, this is my first time being back in this building since August 2011. So I'm a little bit traumatized by that. Because emotionally, I'm still trying to wrap my mind around it. So, but in any event, I'm giving this guy a ride. And unbeknownst to me, he had some stolen items in his belongings. As I took the 91 exit, I see police. But I'm not really, my mind is somewhere else. I'm driving in, and just before we take the exit into Northampton, I see more police. There's a concentration. They're pulling over people. When I come down the ramp, I'm kind of in that middle lane. You know, it's like three lanes, one going left and that short one where you can go right. I'm in the middle one where the guy bails. There's this huge truck right behind us, right? And he bails out. And I'm wondering, what the? But anyways, and I got to go through the light, but I get pulled over. When I get pulled over, the first thing that the state trooper says, like, you don't look like the kind of guy. The kind of guy for what? But then a bell started going off. So he takes me and puts me in his car. The state trooper, he say, want to see my license, take me out of my vehicle, put me in his car and everything. He's asking me, where was I going? I said, I'm going to the board of directors meeting. I said, like, I just want to talk to my lawyer. Because I didn't like where the conversation with him was going. So he took me to the state police barrack. And when he takes me to the state police barrack, he immediately called, after finding out I was on parole, he called my parole officer. This is 7:30, 8 o'clock in the morning. My parole officer immediately issued a parole warrant. So then I was taken from the state police barrack to Orange District Court and arraigned. I was arraigned on charges of breaking and entering and everything, and breaking and entering and something else. I'm like, I didn't do anything, man. I'm like, what is this? What is going on here? So, from the Orange District Court, I was taken to Franklin County Jail. And when I'm taken to Franklin County Jail, I was held there. This is August 3rd. I was booked in August 3rd. August 5th, the institutional parole officer at Franklin County Jail came to me and said, listen, we want to have a parole hearing, a revocation hearing for you next week, the 11th. I'm like, what are you talking about? I haven't done anything. Why are you going to talk about revoking my parole? So I waived that hearing to find out what was actually going on because I knew I hadn't done anything. But ultimately, Amherst Police Department, their forensics, they quartered off whatever crime scene it was, and their forensic proved that my footprints didn't match. And everybody can tell my fingerprints. So they didn't match either. So now it's not about the crime in and of itself, because they said that they wanted to say there was so many breaks and whatever robberies happening in the area, they wanted to make people feel safe. So they needed to lock somebody up. And so in that, I'm the prime candidate for that because I have a history. I'm a second degree lifer on parole. So in the course of that, in the course of them trying to jam me up, they basically want to use my past criminal record, not the incident or the facts that surrounding the actual case. My lawyer, Luke Ryan, came on board as my attorney. And one of the things that we did was, number one, June, we went into court, and we filed a motion to dismiss, knowing that the judge was also a little racist, and that we weren't going to have the case thrown out. But that wasn't the objective. The objective was to have everybody's testimony on the record, so when it came to trial, they couldn't change it. because we noticed at that time that, you know, everybody's testimony or statements were changing. The only person that whose statement stayed the same was mine. And when we actually went to court, well, so back it up, the judge ruled, he denied the motion to dismiss based on a certain state trooper, his testimony. Lo and behold, that trooper told so many lies. He had me convinced about lies. He had me not knowing if my truck had tinted windows or anything. I had to leave the court and go home and call and say, "Is my truck got tinted windows or what's really going on?" I mean, but then ultimately, out of everybody, he's one of the ones that got caught in the most lies during the course of his testimony. But then ultimately, like I said, it wasn't the incident. He was trying to use my past criminal record. We had a four-day trial. The jury's out for less than, for about 2 hours or so. I got unanimous not guilties. And people would readily assume that, okay, since I wasn't treated properly at the initial arrest, then they really assumed that I would leave the courthouse and go home. But that wasn't the case. I was returned to higher custody at Walpole State Prison because of my parole warrant. We had to go through the process of, first of all, my parole being revoked. We had a revocation hearing. And this was July. We had a revocation hearing in September. And going into the revocation hearing, the parole board, it was two parole board members. One of them was really like, really condescending, really, really disrespectful. And he told me in an instance when Luke and I were trying to explain things or answer a question, he would kind of cut us off. And I had to be a little bit assertive verbally in one instance because I was trying to explain to him. I says, "Listen," I says, "I feel like that I woke up August 3rd, 2011. And just like in the Alice in Wonderland fairy tale, when I picked this guy up, my life went right down the rabbit hole." And he said, "But no, this is all procedural and everything." I said, "But, and we're not, it's not us." It was, I said, "Yeah, but based on all these assumptions and allegations, people just, I'm just, you know, I'm feeling the backlash of all of this. This is all costing me." So then, after being a little bit verbally assertive, one of the things he said to me was that he was concerned. He said he agreed. I had an exemplary record while out on parole, but his concern was then, at that point, was that I was going to be re-paroled with a grudge, as if I'd been mistreated. So, but in any event, they tell Luke and Michelle Lusa, who was his assistant at the time, they wanted to file, they, Luke and them filed an appeal, 25-page appeal on my behalf. One of the things they asked their parole board members was my parole being revoked because of my past criminal record? Was it being revoked because of a crime that I was acquitted on? Or was it revoked because a parole board member didn't like my attitude? They never answered that. Instead, they denied the basis of their appeal because their appeal overall was about the violation, about the parole board's violation of their own policies and procedures in dealing with my situation, what I'm sure Luke will talk more about later on. But the bottom line is, we had a hearing March 12th, 2013. At this hearing, like everyone else, I thought that I would be thoroughly interrogated about the events of August 3rd, 2011. When I went in front of the hearing, the first question, and some of you know this, some of you was there. First question that the chairman of the parole board asked me says, "Mr. Perry," they says, "if you had, say, we agree you had an exemplary record while out on parole. If there's anything you could have improved, what would that be?" I'm like, "I don't know, we all got something we can work on." They said, "We noticed you had quite a few relationships while you was on parole." And then, so I told him, I said, "Well, if a relationship didn't work, I moved on." So then he said, "We noticed you had quite a few jobs. Climbing the ladder, I'm getting better jobs." Mm-hmm. So this is my parole hearing was actually 2 hours and 35 minutes. 2 hours and 30 minutes was was spent with relationships, was talked about my past relationships, my past jobs, and why that I feel that I do not need to go to NA and AA. I haven't used drugs in over 30 years. I don't drink, I don't smoke, none of that. Less than 5 minutes was talked about the events of August 3rd. And on average, I had to bring it up. I was referencing. And but then when I finally got my parole decision, I got it September 26th. Based on someone else's aggressive attitude, we ain't call no names. Based on someone else's aggressive attitude that asked that I be immediately released, they penalized me even more so. They penalized me in a sense of saying I had to wait till the following year to be re-paroled out, because basically overall that people are unaware of the fact, but the parole system in Massachusetts does what it wants to do. People talk about the checks and balances, but there's no checks and balances. And so here I am, to make a long story short, though I've crossed all of the T's, dotted all the I's, I still am subjected to the ever-shifting sands of the Massachusetts parole system. As a result of that, of Massachusetts having one of the worst parole systems it is, Holly mentioned earlier, we just finished a documentary with Joe Berlinger called The System. It's an 8-part justice documentary that talks about, it's looking at every flawed aspect of the overall system. And I'm episode number five. We're doing a lot of these public talks now to educate people about my personal experience, but also to raise awareness of just the controversial issues surrounding the Massachusetts parole system and what it means for someone to be on parole. And one of the things, I'm just at this, 2008, Massachusetts has a statute that says that if a person is no longer a threat, that he or she can petition to be taken off parole. A lot of you know that we petition. I had Ellen Story, Chief of Police, Russ Sinkiewicz, Claire Higgins, and numerous other people. We put together a full formal package in 2008. My parole officer lied to me. He sat on it for 8 months, did not submit it until 2 weeks before he was going to retire. And in the course of that, one of the things that they talked about, they said that they had never seen anyone done all of the things that I've done while I was out on parole. And that if they were to terminate anybody's parole, it would be mine. But they said they have a policy, let it sleep, to put it on the desk and wait until something happens. Wait until I die or till an incident happened where I could be locked up again and have to go through the system all over again. Thank you.
Federation for Children with Special Needs, recruiting and training volunteers to be educational advocates for children in residential lockups. She also trains foster, adoptive, and kinship parents across the state on trauma and the impact of trauma on students, on the students' education. She's spent the last 20 years educating and empowering people to advocate for themselves. She's going to talk with you tonight about this experience of being a partner of, in this case, Donald Perry.
Do I have to stand up?
No, you do.
Okay. Hi, welcome. So great to see so many people here. I guess I want to start with the story about how we met. You know, when I met Donald, he was the outreach coordinator here at the office downstairs, doing outreach to homeless people, running a pantry, also working at Not Bread Alone Soup Kitchen, feeding the poor and the homeless. He told me he was on parole when we met, and you know, when I thought about it, I was like, well, you know, I watched him work, you know, I saw what kind of person he was, how compassionate and caring he was, what a hard worker he was. he was like one of those people that had overcome all the obstacles of getting out and starting a life over. You know, he had a good job, he had a car, you know, he had lots of friends and community support. So I thought this was really the kind of person that I wanted to be with and share my life with, because I saw what kind of man he was. We moved in together and we pretty much worked together every day. I also worked with the homeless, and so we were together probably 12 hours a day working 6-7 days a week, and then we were home the rest of the time working on our home. And one of the things that we really enjoyed was when we were at home, you know, like working on our house, you know, working on the garden, you know, having family around, you know, we had just a normal life like any couple would have. So I never thought there was an issue, you know, with, you know, he had told me at one point, you know, well, you know, they could just pick me up. And I'm like, well, that could never happen because, you know, I've never seen you do anything wrong. I mean, I've never even seen you take a pen from work or anything, you know. So I couldn't even imagine anything happening. So when he got picked up on August 3rd, I was just totally surprised, and I heard it from somebody else that called me, and this was the weird thing. They had already printed it in the newspaper before I even knew it happened. It was printed at 8 a.m. that he was picked up, and it basically said that he had burglarized these houses. And I'm like, but he was with me, so this couldn't have happened. And this is how I heard it, was from someone else calling me. This was when I was like, okay, well, this can't be happening. I mean, obviously, it's a mistake. And, you know, well, he'll go in and they'll see that it's a mistake. And, you know, he went down and got arraigned. And I said, well, you know, we can post bail. So I didn't understand that we couldn't post bail. And that was because he's on parole. So parole gets to decide whether they hold you or not. So any normal person that was accused of something could like post bail and be out and still go to work and still come home and still do all this while they're awaiting trial. But because of the parole, he had to be locked up for a year before his trial even came. That was really hard. People in the community were both really harsh and said some really awful things, and we lost some friends. And then once we went to trial, we ended up with a whole set of new friends. You know, that's where I met Vera and Holly and all these people that came forward and said, you know, we believe you, we're there for you. And so it's been kind of this bittersweet thing where, you know, you start to realize who your friends are in the end. Basically, what happened, you know, it's like not only did I get educated about the system, but I got educated about people too, and how people are. Going to visit him was really tough. It's not a fun place to go. You're treated very disrespectfully. You can get yelled at. I got yelled at. I got, you know, searched inappropriately. I got told to leave. I watched people be just taken out of there and just told never to come back. So you try to walk this fine line. It feels like you're being abused, even though you've never even, you know, that you didn't commit a crime. And then you're watching your loved one locked up and watching them go through this horrific experience, and there's nothing you can do about it. And each step of the way I kept thinking, okay, you know, once the trial was over, he's going to come home, you know, a few more days, a few more weeks. And I think I was telling Holly the other day, I said, I just kept ironing his clothes and having them ready, you know. And then it was like, nope, now you have to jump through this hoop. Now you have to go to the revocation hearing. And I'm like, okay, after that, he's going to come home. I'm getting ready, you know, everything. So this whole thing has just been a total shock to me, because I grew up believing that, you know, the system has rules. It's supposed to work. It's supposed to keep us safe. And you know, this was the whole thing. Is you know, I thought that the community would be safe by having the justice system set up the way it was. And now that, you know, I've gone through it in a different manner, it has completely opened my eyes. One of the things I experienced was I saw a lot of people locked up in prison for long periods of time that, like, some had gotten there when they were kids, 16, 17 years old, and they were like 40, 50-year-old men. And I found that very sad, having experiences with the families in the waiting room talking and the experience that happened to them. It's a very costly thing to have your loved one locked up. Not only does it cost the state a lot of money, but the phone calls range from $5 to $15 a piece. For them to have anything to eat, you have to send money. So it becomes this, not only do you lose an income, but then you have to spend all this money to support them and, you know, come up with, you know, lawyer fees and come up with, you know, everything else that's going on. So it's a very isolating thing. I thought once he got home that, I don't know what I thought. I guess I thought it would all be over. but I think it's just beginning. And one of the things is we have regular visits by the parole officer. I mean, he came to the house, and basically I have to sign a sheet saying that he has full access to my house. He can come search it anytime he wants. He can come in anytime he wants. If I feel like Donald is not behaving, that I am to call him and let him know. He told me that him and I were a team and that we would work on this together to help his behavior. That's kind of the way he talked to me, and I'm like, okay. What happens today is every time he leaves the house, I worry now. And I didn't have that before. Before, I thought, you know, nothing could happen. You can't get arrested if you don't do anything wrong. The other day, you know, I was like driving to Springfield, and I count every cop on the road now. There's 9 cops, you know. I know where every exit where they're at. I know where, you know, everything is happening. Your whole life changes, the way you view everything. When you walk in and you see someone with a uniform on, I used to think they were people that were there to help me, and now I kind of have this fear of like, oh God, what now, you know? If he's gone, you know, for the whole day, he always checks in with me, but if it's like he doesn't check in, I'm like, you know, when's he gonna call? Why didn't you call right at 1:30? You're supposed to call me. And so it makes it kind of weird now, because before I just never really thought about it, and you know, we're adults and we come and go, and I trust him and he trusts me, but I don't trust the outside world now. I don't trust the system. And you know, now I question whether that we are in fact jeopardizing our public safety by making it so hard for someone who's been on parole to come out and be in our society. So we're starting all over again, and we do want to come out and share our experience, because I just feel like there's other people that are going through this. And as a family member of someone that's been locked up, one of the things that I talked to a lot of the women that were coming to visit in prison is they didn't want to talk about it because of the shame. And you can't talk to your coworkers about it, and you can't talk to your family about it, and you know, you don't want to just go out and talk to people in public, because you know, you get those comments and you get those looks, and it doesn't always feel safe to share. So I feel really good about sharing here, and I really appreciate all you guys for being here.
Star by New England Super Lawyers. Luke is a cooperating attorney with the ACLU of Massachusetts and is currently serving as local counsel for the Center for Constitutional Rights. And he's working with us on a case that's about Scott Lively, who lives in Springfield and is being charged with persecution, crimes against humanity, and that's a fun one. You can read about it up at the Out Now table. There's some literature on him up there. In 2009, Luke published a law review article with his sister, Molly Ryan Strehorn, on the rights of criminal defendants to access internal affairs files in self-defense cases, and in 2012 published another article on abusive police interrogation practices. From August of 2011 until March of 2014, he had the privilege of defending Donald Perry against the criminal charges he faced in Hampshire County Court and appearing on his behalf, along with his father, W. Michael Ryan, before the Massachusetts Parole Board. I would like to say at Arise, we do call Luke the people's lawyer. He's always there for us. We send in people all of the time and say, we have this member of Arise who's gotten into this trouble. Can you help? And he always does. So I just want to start out with that. We really appreciate having Luke Ryan in our community. So take it away, Luke.
Thanks. Well, thank you all for being here tonight. I guess I'd like to start by just publicly saying a couple of things about Donald and Elaine. These are two very brave people, they are two people who have gone through an awful lot, and I think the instinct at this point for a lot of people would be to just keep your head down, to not ruffle any feathers, to try to just go along to get along, and they've made a different choice here in going public about what their story is, and I do mean their story, because I think, as Elaine just said, the experience that she had of supporting Donald through this was really profound and disturbing. And you know, I 90% of what I know about the parole system comes from these two people. The other 10% comes from my paralegal Michelle Yosa, who did a parole clinic with Patty Guerin, who's not with us tonight. But it has been an eye opener for somebody who practices in the criminal courts, who comes home from work and is distressed and upset about the injustices that I see in that part of the criminal justice system. The parole system is something altogether different. We are talking about a different beast, so to speak. So with that sort of preamble out of the way, I thought it would be helpful to say a little bit about Donald's criminal history and other history. Donald, at one point when he was getting ready to appear before the board for his release in 2001, wrote an essay that was the criminalization and rehabilitation of Donald Perry, which is to this day one of the most articulate and insightful works that I've seen as to anybody have as to explaining you know, behavior that you look at in a sort of two-dimensional way, and we can all say it is not behavior that we would condone. Donald was born in 1954 in North Carolina. This is 5 years before Woolworth lunch counter sit-ins. This is the segregated South. This is Jim Crow. And for anybody who hasn't read the recent Atlantic Monthly piece about the case for reparations, who wants a primer on this era, it is a must read. Donald's family at the time, he was a part of a large family that had very limited choices. And in the context of the choices that they had, Donald, as a young person, experienced a lot of violence. He experienced a lot of trauma. I went to a conference a few weeks ago where there was a neuroscientist there, and he said, just as waves are the practice of water, violence is the practice of trauma. And Donald's upbringing, I think, conditioned him in certain ways to make certain choices. As he would be the first to say, he made those choices. He ultimately turned to criminal behavior. But I think in the larger scheme of things, his choices have to be understood as not altogether difficult to comprehend. Donald, in this essay, talked about never thinking he'd live to see the age of 21. When he turned 21, he just regarded it as something of a miracle, given all the violence, all the death he'd experienced. His world was a world where the most logical choice to be made was one to self-medicate, to use illicit drugs, to escape the realities of being a poor black person, first in North Carolina, and then, like so many people of his generation and race, migrating north, hoping to find better things up here and walking into urban poverty, walking into dysfunctional schools, to redlining, and to limited opportunities. So Donald, by the mid-70s and early 80s, had, in order to finance a drug habit, had begun to rob people. And one of the things that is unusual about Donald's case is, as he mentioned before, he's on he has a second-degree life sentence. In Massachusetts, murder in the first degree is the only crime for which you can be sentenced to life without parole. Other than that, there are a number of other offenses which are called life felonies because you theoretically can be sentenced to life in prison for them. Second-degree murder is a mandatory second-degree life sentence. Most of the people in Massachusetts who are quote-unquote lifers are there because of they've been convicted of second-degree murder. There are other crimes like burglary, rape, and arson that carry with them the potential for life sentences, and they are sometimes imposed, not very often, but almost always after a person has a trial. It is very unusual to have somebody on second-degree life for a non-homicide where there's been a plea, and that is what happened with Donald. In 1983, Donald appeared in court for a number of armed robberies, and he received a 25 to 40 year sentence on all of them but one. There was one remaining charge that didn't get put in with the first batch, and so as after he began serving this sentence was brought back into court where his lawyer had worked out a plea agreement where he was going to get a 4 to 6 year prison sentence that would run concurrently with the 25 to 40 year sentence. As is standard, to plead guilty, the prosecutor reads a statement of facts that the defendant then has to tell the judge, yes, that's more or less what happened. In Donald's case, what happened was, is the prosecutor read into a statement of facts that was asking Donald to agree not only to his own criminal behavior, but to the criminal behavior of a co-defendant that Donald was not prepared to do. It wasn't truthful, and he was being put in a position of being asked to point the finger at somebody for doing something that they didn't do when he was solely responsible, and he was there to take responsibility for his crimes. When Donald told the, basically interrupted this process to say that that's not what happened, a dialogue of sorts evolved that I'm still trying to wrap my head around, because at that point, the prosecutor sort of threw up his hands, said this person isn't taking responsibilities for his crime. The judge said, I agree. And the judge, without hardly a peep from Donald's court-appointed lawyer, said, I'm going to sentence you to life in prison. That's how Donald Perry became a lifer. That happened in 1983. Donald's journey through the state prison system is one that the state prison, the Department of Correction, should be have a seat at this table here tonight, really taking credit for a transformation of a person. Donald, at some point or another, came to the realization that that he wanted more out of his life, and he was in a fortunate enough situation to be exposed to some programming that was actually quite good. And as soon as Donald got a taste for developing himself, for looking at the root causes of his behavior, he did not stop. He has not stopped. And so finally in 2001, after appearing in 1999 and getting what's known as a 2 year setback, and if you can just sort of bookmark the term setback, I want to talk about that in a second. In 2001, Donald was paroled. And over the course of the next 10 years, he did absolutely anything and everything you could ever hope somebody to do while on parole. He was, as he said, a member of a board of directors. He was a part of the Tri-County Care Continuum. They dealt with homeless issues. He was a go-to person for people in law enforcement, for people in city government, somebody who understood the people that he was serving in a unique way and was incredibly good at his job and knew enough to where it was appropriate to put boundaries, knew enough when you had people who were really doing the best they could and did deserve to be cut a little slack. In any event, he's talked about what happened on August 11th, or August 3rd of 2011. Only thing I would add to that that whole thing is he did have a four-day trial. He was found not guilty, and like everybody else in that courtroom, my natural assumption at that point was that Donald Perry would be coming home. And it's one of those things that I don't think I've ever experienced as a lawyer before of representing somebody and recognizing as I'm doing it what an important part he was of our social safety net. There would be times when I'd be working on his case where I'd be up late at night going to try to get a coffee to stay up a little later, and I'd pass people on the street, street people, who it would occur to me as I'd pass by and, you know, throw a dollar in their basket that these are the people who were most missing Donald Perry. These were the people whose stories he knew. These were the people that he knew where to check on them. He knew how to check on them. In any event, we appeared for what is known as a revocation hearing before the parole board on September 10th of 2012. In advance of that hearing, we attempted to basically bring live witnesses in to confront Donald's accusers who had testified at trial and to basically have our little mini trial before the two-person panel. Those requests were denied. We were not permitted to call any witnesses. We weren't permitted to confront any witnesses against Donald. We had provided them with a transcript of his trial. We had been as open a book as possible. And essentially what happened was is the parole board decided that despite the fact that a jury had found Donald not guilty of the crimes he'd been charged with, that they knew better than the jury, that based on reading the transcript, they could see that he had actually violated the law and was guilty. My father, who's here, is going to be talking a little later, may talk a little bit about this, but there's sort of a cardinal rule of reviewing bodies, of appellate courts, and that is that you do not make credibility determinations based on something known as a cold record. That the reason we have juries is so that they can listen to people telling competing stories and look at their body language, look at the way they take pauses before answering questions, or look away, or appear confused that don't show up on a transcript. The parole board totally disregarded this, and they found that Donald was in violation, he'd broken the law, and they revoked his parole. At this point, as Donald said, we filed an appeal on his behalf, and we pointed to various problems with their determination, one of which being we didn't get what the Constitution requires, which is the opportunity to put on a defense here. Before we filed this pleading, we took steps to make sure that this was not going to delay Donald's release hearing. And the reason that we did that is because the people that we appealed to were the same people that decided to revoke his parole. That's one of the real eye-openers in this system, is there is no higher authority that you can turn to. You essentially have to turn to the people who have deprived your client of their rights in order to show them how they screwed up and ask them to acknowledge their error. The prospects of success are not high in this. So after being assured that this would not in any way delay Donald's opportunity to have a release hearing that would happen in December, we filed our appeal. Soon as we did, the December list came out, and lo and behold, Donald Perry's name was not on it. He was not given his opportunity to appear for a release hearing in December, or in January, or in February. When he finally did appear before the board in March, by that point, his case had gone viral. It had gone viral because some very good and committed people a lot of whom are here tonight, spent a lot of time getting a website together and pounding the pavement and getting signatures. And by the time the day rolled around for the hearing, over 144,000 people had signed a petition asking for his immediate release. I was not able to appear that day. I had a jury out in another case. My father stepped in and after meeting Donald for about 10 minutes advocated for him before the board. The final thing I want to say is just about the opinion that was ultimately came down in September of last year that finally addressed the request for a release. It's an opinion that if you ever have a chance to read it, is kind of at war with itself. By this time, the board had sort of committed itself to the idea that they didn't believe Donald Perry, that they thought that he had something to do with these criminal offenses. The problem that they had was they knew that if they gave him a five-year setback, there was those 144,000 petitions were going to go to the governor's desk, and they were going to have a rare problem. For the parole board, almost 99.9% of the times, the problems that they experience are when they take a chance on somebody and that somebody goes out and commits a serious crime. Nobody ordinarily cares about the other people who it wouldn't be much of a chance to let go, but because they're convicts, they're not let go, so there's a few family members who are disappointed. Well, in this case, I think they were smart enough to know that they were going to have a public relations crisis on their hand. So they had to walk this fine line, and what they ultimately ended up saying is, we think that this man who's sitting before you today committed these crimes. We think that he went into court and he committed perjury. He lied about it before his jury and saying that it was a third party that he hadn't met before that day. We think that after that happened, he went to his revocation hearing and he lied about it again. And we think that he has somehow managed to convince more people than live in the city of Springfield that he was telling the truth. In spite of all that, we're going to let him go. If the parole board really believed that Donald did this, I don't think they would have had any problem in actually keeping him in. They should have kept him in, given the duplicity that they accuse him of. But they essentially said, we find he's done all these good things, and so with another 6 months for good measure, or 7 months for good measure, we're going to see that he's released. I should also say that when that release day came around, and you can imagine, as Elaine said, that every single day what it means. There's an old Oscar Wilde poem that talks about what a day incarceration means to a human being. When that day finally came around, there was nothing in place that was ready for Donald Perry to get out. He didn't get out that day, or the day after, or the day after that. Elaine and I were calling, sending faxes, writing letters. It was it was really sort of a comedy of errors and a lot of finger pointing as to who should have had
the key.
Yeah, the key to unlock the cell. So, you know, his experience is not over. He's subjected to electronic monitoring. He has these incredible invasions that happen on a regular basis. And I think mostly it comes down to the fact that the parole board wants to show Donald Perry who's in charge. I said earlier to bookmark this idea of a setback in your heads. If Patty Guerin were here today, one of the things that she would say is that there has been a bill introduced that's before the House Judiciary Committee in Massachusetts that seeks to increase the time period by which the parole board has to review people who are serving life sentences for release. By law, every 5 years now, they have to bring the person back before the board and see what kind of progress they've made and whether or not they might now be a candidate for release. The bill that's been introduced would double that to a 10-year period. It would essentially say to a person, we'll see you in a decade if we don't like where you're at right now. It is basically the equivalent of just disappearing a human being and making sure that they don't have even the prospect of freedom on a limited parole basis. It's a bad piece of legislation. It is inhuman. It does not serve society. It gives a person no incentive to rehabilitate themselves, and it ought to be defeated. So I'd encourage you all to call your representatives and urge that they take action to ensure that it goes no farther than where it's at. Thank you all again for coming, and yeah, thank you for being here for these two.
Brian up here after Vera, and if you all want to slide down, because we'll keep you all in order. And that bill, you can call your House rep about that. So it's running through the House right now, the bill that Luke is referring to. So I'm now going to introduce you to Vera Duanami Cage. Vera is going to speak a successful grassroots campaign called Justice for Charles. The dedicated efforts of a diverse group of participant organizers and many supporters helped pave the way for the January 2013 exoneration of her nephew, Charles Wilhite, from a December 2010 wrongful murder conviction in which a Hampden County judge sentenced Charles to a mandatory life imprisonment without a chance of parole sentence. Vera is the new ACLU of Mass Springfield organizer working to help end the criminalization of youth in school discipline, otherwise known as the school-to-prison pipeline. Vera is also a member of Arise, and I'm happy you're on this panel with us. Take it away.
It's emotional.
I know.
And I don't know how you all can hold it in.
I know.
So I'll be emotional for y'all at this moment. It's a miracle.
The canary in the coal mine, right?
It's a miracle that Mr. Donald Perry is here with us in this room. Learned so much from attending the trial. Learned so much about the horror of the criminal injustice system. So part of the reason why I'm here is to share with folks the various opportunities that normal, regular people, you and I, moms, dads, you know, our kids, can intervene and to interrupt and to get educated and get our consciousness raised around these problems. Because it won't get fixed and it won't change until we get involved, until we care. Earlier today, I had lunch with an attorney that represents juveniles. And my work is in Springfield right now, and we're looking at why we're disciplining kids out of school, right? Why in Springfield there's police officers in the schools and they're the first response for when teachers are overwhelmed and need assistance and need support. And so, you know, and he tells me of his 7 years experience doing this work. How can this happen? How can we allow children to not attend school? You know, how can, you know, we allow kids to be absent from school for 6 days, 60 days, until somebody says there's a problem, right? And so it's not just the schools. It's not just, you know, the principals and the teachers or whatever. It's also how the whole state is involved, right? And also, you know, our reluctance and our denial that, you know, our community's suffering, right? How come no one, you know, pays a visit to the homes and sees what's going on, you know? So it's all related, you know? So being part of Arise for Social Justice, being on the board, you know, I learned so much about the intersections of housing instability, the intersections of poverty and racism, and the need for regular people to just push against the system and say, you know, we can't accept this, we refuse to accept this, and how that looks, you know, for folks like out now and at Arise, how some of you folks in this audience are part of working in alliance and coalition in support of people who are really suffering in other parts of the valley. And so my experience and exposure to being involved in this work has been very short, you know. And when we tried to get support and build support for Charles Wilhite, my nephew, we went to the folk to Arise for Social Justice. And I learned about, okay, they're gonna be, you know, holding signs at the Chicopee Courthouse. And this was around Melvin Jones, who was beaten up by a Springfield police officer, Asher. And, you know, it was a miracle this police officer was getting charged with the crime. And so, you know, I saw Dan Keefe, I saw Holly, I saw Ellen Graves holding signs, bravely doing so. And I joined in with them, and that was my first exposure to really, you know, holding a sign against, you know, I've held signs as a labor organizer, as a union organizer, and community organizer, but you know, different when you're dealing with the police and the district attorney's office and all those, what we call the criminal justice system. And so that was huge. That was like sort of my opening and awakening. And then when this opportunity came forward to show solidarity for Mr. Donald Perry, it was an opportunity to also be in the courtroom with, you know, Attorney Luke Ryan, right? And just to see, this was the attorney that helped Jason Vassal, right? Joe Markins here, he's one of the organizers that was involved with the Justice for Jason campaign that was here some years ago. And if it wasn't for young organizers like Joe and Dan and many others, I don't think my nephew would have had a chance because we didn't have such an immediate blueprint for change. And it was those folks, those young people at the UMass Amherst campus that said, you know, let's put together a listserv, let's put together a website, let's, you know, send messages out everywhere and recruit everyone and leave no stone unturned. And so that was just how we operated. And we weren't an organization, we weren't a 501c3, but we welcomed the help of everybody, you know, and all organizations. And really the ones that stepped forward were these organizations. It was Holly, it was Ellen, it was Michael Land, and being able to have the opportunity to be with Amy Bookbinder and Pocky Whelan, you know, it's just amazing. The same faces show up to be in support of, for me, Donald's a stranger, you know. And interestingly enough, I'm a resident of Amherst, and it was Pastor Vicki Kemper from a church in Amherst who said, you know, my husband Edward should meet Donald. And so she gave us his phone number, and we were calling the number. It was like and no answer. And it was because Donald was caught up, right? And we didn't realize this. And so, you know, there's all these intersections. But Mr. Donald Perry, he's my husband's African American, you know, and he also, you know, has served time in prison. And we have two children. One's in the fifth grade and one's in the second grade. And it's also these, you know, parallels of the parole, of not forgiving, of not giving people a chance, you know. You know, Mr. Donald Perry was helpful in doing the Corey reform to say that people who, you know, made past mistakes should have an opportunity to get, you know, into employment, right? Get into housing and all those things that we know move a family forward, move individuals forward. And I also want to say it's I'm all over the place a little bit, but Elaine was so helpful in being the individual that she was, that was, you know, open to support, open to help, open to just bearing her soul. I mean, she was in the courtroom and she took the stand, and she's the same person that took the stand that's out here with us today. And now, you know, our circles, you know, thankfully are overlapping, and we'll probably see each other in various trainings and workshops, so I'm grateful for that opportunity. But I guess my point is that anybody and everybody can make a difference, and we all should, you know. There's no reason why we can't. I went to the parole hearing, and because I what I learned in the courtroom was that, you know, when you're on parole, you can't just go to Connecticut or Rhode Island for an hour or two or three. You can't. And that was amazing to me, what you can learn just from being, you know, in the room. And it's a public space, you know, courtrooms are public spaces. We need to be there, we need to observe, we need to bear witness. And that's the only way that we can be moved enough to physically be there for people. It's not enough to just click on a sign on a petition online, you know. It's helpful if you're out of state, you know, and you want the numbers. But we really need to push ourselves to do more than that, you know. I quit my job to help my nephew, and for me, it was like, how can I see, you know, another human being lose their freedom? How can I live with myself? You know, I was born in Laos. I'm not born in this country, but, you know, we've lived in the city, we've lived in the suburbs. I was in the Thai refugee camps for a little bit. So I know that there are many realities in this world, in this right now, there are many realities. And for me, learning about slavery, U.S. slavery, it was like, well, how could that happen? How could another human being see another human being enslaved and not feel and just move normally, right? Like, and just exist and coexist with oppression, with slavery. And for us today, it's about how can we exist with so many people locked up, you know, in our prisons, in our jails. How can we allow people who can't afford bail, who haven't even been convicted, to spend, you know, 2, 3, 4, 6 a year, 2 years in jail because they can't afford, you know, $1,000 or $10,000, you know, and how can we allow so many of our kids at such an early age, when we know that if you drop out of school, if you get caught up in the court system, you're more likely, you know, to commit a crime and go to jail for it, especially if you're poor and you have. You lack the resources and advocates, you know, and so to move forward a little bit, I think all these different various campaigns, you've heard about Justice for Jason a little bit, Justice for Charles, Justice for Donald Perry, and there's other movements and campaign that's happening right now, that regular people are coming together from various places. To say, well, how can we, learning about this injustice, how can we work together to effect change? And the latest campaign that's happening, there's many, multiple ones, but the Justice for RU, some members are here as well. So there's so many things that we can learn from one another, but I think it we could all say that we could use more people, we could use more support, we could use more solidarity. And there's so many places and so many events, and if you don't have to go to regular, you know, campaign meetings, you can just show up to court, you know, when people put out the word. Mm-hmm. Make sure, you know, Holly passed out a sign-up sheet, send her your email, and you'll be informed of when you're most needed, and it counts. It counts, you know. And for me, crying is transformative. It helps me. It's cathartic. I cried all the way coming here. I didn't cry really before, but taken in totality, things have to change. And for me, it's organizing. It's not about. It's pushing aside, you know,
the feeling of helplessness and hopelessness and isolation, and saying, you know, if I'm feeling so horribly and so bad, and it feels like I can't live anymore, taking my own life is not gonna change anything. It's about getting so many more people involved to care and to do the work of effecting change and figuring that out, and how do we do it together. So that's the point. It's about solidarity, it's about building movements, it's about helping each other out, you know, and you're needed, and you have a role to play. Thank you.
Thank you, Vera. I think just in terms of, you know, court solidarity, people coming to court and witnessing what's going on in court, it does matter. It matters when there are a group of people sitting behind a defendant, and people, the jury or whomever, is looking at the fact that the community is supporting this person. I believe that that goes in somewhere in an unconscious way. And we've had great success in the cases that we've taken on and people winning their freedom. And I do think that there is a big role for you all to play. And we do have your info that you've given us as you've signed in. So we'll be keeping you in the loop on these things. So I'm going to move now to retired Judge Michael Ryan, who is a graduate of the University of Massachusetts and Western New England School of Law. He's a U.S. Army vet. He's been a court officer, a probation officer, a defense attorney, Northwestern District Attorney, civil litigator, Mass District Court Justice, First Justice, Northampton District Court, and since his retirement from the bench in 2008, Attorney Ryan has maintained a general practice of law in Northampton with a concentration on personal injury litigation. His published works include historical articles, legal essays, poems, plays, biographies, national golf magazines, and local golf course reviews. Mr. Ryan joined in on Donald Perry's case when Donald's lawyer, Luke, was not able to attend in March 2013 in his parole hearing in Natick.
Honestly, he gave me about as much notice I was going to be on this panel as he gave me that I was going to represent Donald. And listen, when it was such an education to me. You heard the list. I had done everything I thought that you could do in the criminal justice system. But I had never been to a parole hearing. I had no idea how it worked. Luke was in trial. They couldn't get anything. Donald was going to represent himself. And I said, well, Steve,
Philbrick
was going. He's a friend of mine. I said, well, geez, I'll ride down. And I had never met Donald. And Donald didn't know I was coming. You can't call him. He said, yeah, there was no way to communicate. Yeah. There's no email. There was nothing. Yeah. So I went in and said, hello, I'm going to be your lawyer. I'm Luke's dad, and I'll do my best that I can. And honestly, I thought we did a good job. But it was such an eye-opener for me, and it very disheartening. I feel very sad about the process. I never knew. There were times when I had some authority and power, and I could do something about it. I never knew about parole. But I was blown away by, first of all, I got down there, and I'm pretty good about picking out people that I can ally with. And there was a young woman that was working there. I don't remember her name, for the parole board. And I said, you know, it's my first time coming, and I'm a last-minute fill-in. I'd like to just kind of get the lay of the land. What's a good approach to do there? And she said, well, don't do what your son did. You know, don't appeal it. You know, that's why we're here now. And it was like, are you kidding me? He appealed it, so they had to wait 4 or 5 months for this. And it really became very clear that, you know, you better get down on your knees and crawl and beg. And it was just, you know, as a retired judge, I'm not used to having to do that. But it was really clear that one of the things you had to do was bow and scrape and I mean, it was so freaking offensive. And, you know, I went through, I was trained in the Army, and you know, I went through the South in 1967, 68, and I saw the way the society treated black people down there, and really to stay alive, you know, it was no back talk, your bones scrape, and just surrender your humanity, and your, it just, it was so degrading. And I felt so degraded in there, but I wanted to do the best I could do for Donald, and there was a huge amount of support there, and there was such good feeling of everybody that we were going to go in there. And I had talked to Luke, of course, through the trial, and I knew about Donald's background, and I knew the good he did. And I mean, it was like he should be the poster child for the incarceration system. They should be bragging about him and saying, you know, it works. Look at this guy. Look at the good he's done. Look at the people he's helped, the programs he started. I mean, it was, he was such an easy client in that situation to say, this person's deserving of parole. Look how well he did on parole before. And they told me we'd hear, what, I think it was like 6 weeks you'll get a decision, which I thought was kind of long. And then, but then they explained that there were people that weren't there who were going to vote on it, and they'd listen to the tape, and I thought that was a little strange. And the more I got, the more stranger it got. And then they put things off, and put, it was 6 weeks, and then it was. But I called, and I really got the impression, if you call too often, you're a pain in the ass, you're a pain in the ass, you complain about this weight, and you go down the bottom of the pile, and they're going to punish you for calling and making inquiries. So it was, it's this sense of helplessness that this innocent person is in this horrific situation, and if you try to help him, you will hurt him, they will punish him. And I mean, Luke was talking about the decision. I filed an appearance, I gave my address, everything. They filed a decision, they never sent it to me. I mean, they don't, it's like, they don't practice the common courtesies of a court system. There was no constitutional protections at all. There was no, we didn't even know what they were complaining about, what violation they found. You know, basically, you know, the police said you did something wrong, so we're going to punish you. It was, and in the trial, I mean, this was a different type of trial than, an unusual type of trial, in that there wasn't a lot of challenge by Luke to the police information, the witness said that they gave. Little tiny things, but for the most part, nobody was calling the cops liars. Nobody was attacking the police. Nobody was saying this. Basically, the defense was, based on the information they had, which was partial, their conclusion was wrong. And this is the information that they didn't have. And when they have this information, look at all the information, he's obviously innocent. And it wasn't, it was no challenge to the establishment. There was no attack on it. There were some little things there where, you know, your lawyer, you're cross-examining, but not the usual conflict that you see. It was, the police didn't have the whole picture. It's like, originally, he charged him with breaking and entering in these places, and then, of course, he was alibied by Elaine, but the other thing, there were prints on the scene that didn't match him. So they knew it was somebody else that had broken into this place. It was, on all the information, the jury found him not guilty, and that had no impact on the parole board. They read the testimony of the witnesses, and without watching the demeanor, hearing the pace of the language, seeing any confusion in the eye, any questioning, the things that we use to decide whether somebody's being truthful or honest. They decided Donald Perry was lying, the police, you know, made the right conclusions, and that he did something wrong. I don't think they could ever decide what he did wrong, but they were going to put him back in jail, and they were going to hold him there, and if anybody tried to get him out, damn it, they were going to keep him there longer. You know, I was in school in the 60s. I went to a lot of protest meetings. There were people saying, you know, let's go to the barricades. Let's go. Let's take down the establishment. Let's do this. And I was influenced by, when I was in the Army, this guy, he was a Private Braxton. And he claimed that he and the supply clerks in Vietnam ended the war by sending supplies to the wrong place. And he says, one saboteur is better than 1,000 people at the gates, you know. And so I always thought, well, the Braxton, I'm in there, but I can work for social justice from inside. But, you know, I sit back now and I think of the things that I spent my life, the ideals that I thought were important. And when I started practicing law, when I came of age, we had 200,000 people in America incarcerated. And, you know, my generation, we're going to reduce that. There's a lot of people, I'm sure, that were in the same point of mind, same place I was. And we're going to work for social justice. We're going to make some changes. Today we have 2 million. I mean, it's like, you know, we were going to work for peace and, you know, and we're fighting everywhere in the world. It's like, I don't know what happened, but all this stuff. And then I went to Donald Perry's thing, and it just had this profound impact on me about what, how can they do this? How can, it's just so arbitrary. As a matter of fact, I was saying, Luke, I think it's un-American. I mean, if you believe in American values, and it's idealistic, yeah, when you know, but if you believe in it, in the rights and the Constitution, and if you, these people don't. They have no respect for a jury system, no respect for the right to confront witnesses against you, the right to be informed of the charges against you, the right to have impartial people decide your fate. There's none of that in this parole situation. And it's caused me to look at, you know, my career and say, whoa, what can be done? I agree, Luke, it was those petitions. And the crowd that went to that trial had a profound effect. I mean, you know, they're... When people of privilege are accused of an offense and they're there, they have their mother, father, brothers, sisters, family, neighbors, you know, people who can afford to take time off from work. People aren't going to get fired if they do it. They can get somebody else to tend the store or something. They have 20, 30, 40 people there. Most times for, you know, people who can't afford a lawyer, they go in there. They're by themselves. They might have, you know, a wife, a partner, you know, a parent, but... they're alone, and having a crowd, when you're a trier factor, look at it. It has an effect. You know, there's karma. You can feel what's going on in that courtroom. You can feel what people are doing. It. Juries feel it. Judges feel it. You have a big crowd in there that's supporting and believing in the accused. It changes things. It changes everything. The scales might be even level, you know, maybe there you do have a chance. So don't underestimate at all the impact that you can have by standing up and supporting accused when, you know, you believe that they're not being treated fairly or they're falsely accused. It does, and it's I think one of the reasons why this parole board gets away with what it does is because their hearings are so secret. I mean, every one of us who went into that hearing, we had to be humiliated. I think we had to sign a promise of allegiance to the United States or something. We had to sign forms and make promises, and they checked our records, and they had to, it was, you know, as a lawyer, I've gone to courthouses all over the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. Early in my career, I wanted, before I end, I'm gonna go to every one of them. And, they kept on making them and tearing down the ones I went to, so I gave that up a long time ago. But it was, I would never, as an advocate, had to go through what I did to get into that hearing. And we had a couple of people that went down, and they didn't have a photo ID, so they couldn't get in. And there was, it is so disheartening. And coming in here today, and you don't know how I feel like I see you out, Donald, but coming in and going through it again, I just get, it's almost despair that.
I'm gonna cheer you up a bit if I can segue to Dr. D'Angelo.
Yeah, I'm talking too long. I didn't have anything prepared. I stole my speech.
I think we'll get this context. You're maybe the perfect one for her to be following to sort of wrap this up. Dr. Robin D'Angelo is a friend of mine and is an associate professor of multicultural education at Westfield State University. Her research is concerned with the challenges of an increasingly white teaching force and an increasingly diverse student population. She has twice been honored with the Students' Choice Award for Educator of the Year. In addition to her academic work, Dr. D'Angelo has extensive experience as a workplace consultant on race relations and racial justice. She was appointed to co-design, develop, and deliver the Race and Social Justice Initiative anti-racism training for the city of Seattle. She has numerous publications on racism and whiteness, in which her goal is to make white complicity in racism visible. She just released her second book, What Does It Mean to Be White? White Racial Literacy. Dr. D'Angelo, welcome.
While our panel has done a beautiful job of helping you see the specifics of Donald's case, I've been asked to kind of look at the big backdrop that this is set against, and I'm just going to go say it. The backdrop is white supremacy. That is what Charles Wright Mills calls the political system that has made the modern world what it is today, that is never named and never marked, right? So before I kind of explain what do I mean by white supremacy and whiteness, and I want to position myself explicitly as a white person. So I'm speaking to you as a white person, and a lot of what I'm talking about are the patterns and the socializations of white people collectively, you know, at the group level. And, you know, as an insider who spent, well, my lifetime, but a good 20 years of intentional focus and study trying to understand whiteness, I do have some insight and some expertise. I'm also will never truly understand whiteness because of my own investments in it. So I want to kind of just position myself there and talk about what I mean by white supremacy. In order to talk about that, I've talked about racism. And I have to challenge the way that I know I have been taught to think about racism and that I know is reinforced every day. And we're taught in mainstream society to think of racism as an either-or kind of situation, right? Either somebody perpetrates it or doesn't perpetrate it. So it's an individual, right? Did that individual do it or did they not do it? It's an individual act done by individuals. And of course, if they're good people, they didn't do it. And if they did do it, they're not good people. So you also have this binary of racism is about individuals and it's about good and bad. And just about anything you hear on the news or anybody discussing it, it's really clear that that's the way they're talking about it. That's why you're going to get witnesses for Paula Deen saying she's a nice person, right? That somehow if she's a good person or it wasn't, well, then there's another layer, which it has to also be intentional and conscious. So it's a really great setup for me not to relate to it at all, and for really most any white person is not going to relate to it, and we're going to feel mighty defensive if you try to relate us to it. So that's what I get to do in 15 minutes is to connect all these lovely white people in here to this system, because yes, you care, and you are here, and we're all colluding. And if we can't see it, I mean, I think it was so powerful, that theme, that people didn't see it, right? That you two are in the legal system, you are a judge, and you're saying there are big pieces of that system that you didn't see. If we can't see it, we can't challenge it. So racism is a system that is completely and utterly integrated and embedded in everything, and it's happening 24/7. The question is not, did racism occur? The question is, How did it play out in that situation? How is it playing out in this room? How is it playing out in the way that we talk about this? That question will guide very different vision and certainly very different responses than did it or didn't it, let's debate, right? Which is, it's an incredibly adaptive and clever system too. So it doesn't look like, well, in some ways I think it kind of does look like the South under Jim Crow, if we really look at segregation. But it doesn't look the way that it did back in the 60s. But the outcomes are basically the same and they're similar. So we have to figure out what are we doing that is allowing the outcomes to be the same while each of us, for the most part, feels like we're outside of it. So it's a system that functions to channel resources to white people over people of color. It is not, there's no such thing as reverse, it's not a fluid system. It is a system that is deeply embedded that challenges resources to white people and away from people of color. And there's a metaphor that I love, and it just seems so relevant to what we've been talking about, and it's Marilyn Frye is a feminist scholar who has a metaphor of a birdcage to talk about oppression. Mm-hmm. And that when you walk up to the bars of a birdcage, if I put my face right up against it, I wouldn't really see the bars anymore, right? Just very barely in my peripheral vision, I'd be looking at the bird and like, what's the problem? The bird is free. Why doesn't the bird fly away? Why doesn't he just make better choices, right? Why didn't he just kowtow a little bit more, right? Why don't they work harder? I could go on. But if I step back and begin to take a more macro or large view, I begin to see those wires and that they're interlocking. And racism is an interlocking system. And again, I was struck by you're in the institution of the legal system and there's whole layers that you don't see, right? Just think about those wires are in large part institutions, and then think about how many wires institutions have. Each instance, I'm in education, and I can tell you, education is a primary site of the reproduction of racism. You know, Uncle Tom at the dinner table, why don't you call him out when he makes that joke? Because you don't want to, you know, make him uncomfortable or cause conflict, right? That solidarity that will kind of opt for comfort rather than justice, right? Okay. And it does not have to be conscious. I mean, I don't think it's very far from the surface, to be honest. The more I look at it, the more you just slightly scratch on white folks around race and they're going to explode, right? You ever notice that? Right? It doesn't take much, right? So it's very easy for me to see how it's conscious. My the message of white superiority is just so loud and so clear to me. And also, there are aspects that are deeply, deeply unconscious. So if we're looking for us to be aware of it, we're not going to see it. And our need to deny it is also going to be really strong because of this good-bad, right? So we're thinking that if we define racism as in terms of morality, we're not going to be able to fight it. It is a deeply, profoundly immoral system. But if we think about it as our individual morality, then we're probably not going to be so motivated, right? Kids can't kind of have to throw that out. So it also affects how we see the world, how we think about the world, how we think about ourselves, and about everyday kind of patterns and ways of being, okay? I'll talk about a couple and then some key ones that are related to, I think, what we're talking about today. So individualism is a really powerful kind of ideology of whiteness, right? That we're taught to value ourselves as individuals and see ourselves as individuals. So even now, as I'm talking and I'm talking about white people in general terms, some people might be getting their backs up a little bit, right? Like, well, you don't know me, right? You don't know how I might be different from other white people. So individualism is a very cherished Western ideology, but it is a privilege only available to white folks. I mean, I'm an individual, but Donald is not. Donald is a black man. I'm a woman. Okay. So we named it on gender, but we don't have to name it on race. So individualism is a really cherished ideology that functions to keep us complicit in racism. Not being willing to grapple with, yes, and what does it mean to be white, and how is it manifesting, and how is it holding this in place, right? In a way, the center depends on the extremes out here. Right? And then universalism. And I like to say that it doesn't have to be rational or it doesn't have to align. As long as it works to take race off the table, we'll use it. So if we're not insisting that we're all individuals and that that's the answer, then we'll often insist that we're all human, right? We all bleed under the skin. And you know, if we look at it like that. And on some level, like, yes, of course we're all individuals, and of course we are also you know, we have shared humanity, but neither of those discourses are going to help us look at racism, right? Both of those are going to take it off the table. So for me, the question is always not is it true or is it false, but how does it function in terms of challenging racism? And those narratives in this present moment, someday we'll be in the world that individuals and universalism are real, but we don't live in that world. And so when we default to that, we take race off the table, and we're not going to be able to see this. Okay. There are a lot of other patterns, but a couple I want to pull out that I think are really relevant to keeping us actively complicit in this is our preference for segregation. Okay, so it's not a fluke. It doesn't just happen. We choose it and we reproduce it, and I think we need to be honest that we prefer it. I think that if you look around the room, it pretty much reflects the demographics of Northampton. And I want you to think about some of the narratives around Northampton. Why would we call this paradise? Why would we call this Happy Valley, right? Like, paradise for whom, right? There's something so powerful, I think, in the reproduction of white supremacy for us to talk about segregated white communities as wonderful and use terms like sheltered and safe. And that when we do that, we are reproducing the situations that are going to cause me to not give you the presumption of innocence. That's what we're reinforcing when we do that. So another way that I think about it in terms of my own internalization is no one who loved me, guided me, taught me, mentored me, you know, across my life ever conveyed to me that there was any loss in segregation. In fact, that is the way, for the most part, white people measure the value of our spaces by the absence of people of color. Okay, and I'm not trying to shame anybody. I just want us to get really real and look at what does this do? It's a different way of looking at it, but it's going to change. I think it can change what we see and also what we're reinforcing, right? Because I am, when you said, anybody ever do anything bad? I mean, please, okay, illegal. Like, but I'm presumed innocent, and if I do get caught, they're going to look for the factors outside of it. And I believe that these stories that we tell and our preference for segregation keeps that alive, and that we need to stop actually seeing segregated spaces as wonderful and innocent. They're not innocent. We are not innocent in those spaces. They are actively reinforcing to